It is my pleasure to welcome you this afternoon on behalf of the faculty, the trustees, the students, the graduates, and most especially the soon-to-be graduates of Pacific School of Religion. For 147 years, Pacific School of Religion has been educating and forming leaders for the existing and the emerging church. Today, we gather to sustain and commit ourselves again to that bold and proud tradition. It is who we are, it is what we do, it is why we are here. Today, we celebrate those who have passed their courses, paid their bills, and have heard particularly the gentle voice of God or some holy higher power calling them to an extraordinary calling. We celebrate with them in their ministries, known and unknown, and yet to be unfolded before them. Today, we also celebrate the renewal of the vision of Pacific School of Religion, for we are not only about educating leaders for the existing and the emerging church. We are also about educating leaders outside of the church who share our values and vision for a transformed world in which the community of God's beloved is truly lived out and made possible. Today, we celebrate with the inaugural class of Changemaker Fellows. A body and gifted group. This, too, is who PSR is and why we are here. We believe that our role as faculty and institution is to form leaders who will more closely bring the world into alignment with God's imagination. Today, we commission those who are before us not just academically, but with the spirit of their own particular faith, tradition, and calling to enter that world with justice, with joy, and with peace. We welcome all of you to a celebration of this commissioning, commencement, and sending forth. It's my pleasure now to welcome Dr. Rhys Pottervell, the president of the Graduate Theological Union, for a few words of welcome.
Well, it does feel very special to have seen your beginning for many of you and watched you over these years as you prepare for this day. I'm pleased to bring you greetings on behalf of the Graduate Theological Union at this special time of completion, celebration, and transition. Together, we are part of a remarkable consortium of schools, centers, affiliates, institutes, names we have not yet invented, that includes Protestants, Catholics, Orthodox Christians, Jews, Buddhists, Muslims, and now beginning next fall, Hindus, and other followers of the Dharma traditions. Your education and development as leaders has taken place in this rich mix of diverse traditions and religious perspectives. Whether your vocation and calling will be contributing to the life of the church, or some form of entrepreneurial ministry, or transformational work, or work in the nonprofit sector, education, chaplaincy, you will be working with diverse people, and people whose faith will likely have been shaped and formed by other texts and contexts than your own. Your education here has introduced you to both the enriching opportunities and the challenges of that work, presented by working with the diversity that our global relationships provide. Our world needs your leadership and contributions, We offer you this day our congratulations. Our hope for the future is in part based upon the fact that you are now finished and going forth to do the ministries that you will define and to share your gifts with our world in need. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. Can you hear me?
Okay.
We will be calling for a prayer of invocation to the five directions, which is a practice that's practiced in many parts of the world, across the world. And so I invite you all, as the Spirit moves, if you feel so led, to follow us in the directions that we're going to be praying to. Thank you. So we're starting with the east, this way. Spirit of the East, House of Light, may you provide wisdom to dwell in us so that we may be filled with clarity in all things that we see. And now we're going to the south, facing this way.
Spirit of the South, fire, energy, life. The energy that pushes a seed out from beneath the earth. The fire and passion that drives us through our studies and our life. Welcome, fire.
To the West. The call on the powers of the West, power of water, that which soothes our emotions and lets us flow through the universe and do what we need. The water, the West is also where the ancestors leave this world, and we thank them for what has gone before. Powers of the West, we welcome you.
We call to the spirits of the North, the earth that lies beneath our feet, always holding us in this life. Spirits of this land, ancestors of this land, the Chichenyo Ohlone people, the first people of this land, we say thank you, and we pray for right relationship with your descendants. Hail and welcome, North.
And we welcome the center, divine light, spirit, the grounding, the divine, the sacred in this place, at this time, in this beloved community. Welcome, center. Blessed be.
Call to worship. From the arid desert we have journeyed.
In parched lands we have dwelled.
Into the wilderness we are called.
To bring hope on the winds of change.
We are wilderness people, journeying in bold new directions.
Deep rivers of faith have strengthened us.
Waves of urgent questions have compelled us.
The shifting currents of our world lead us forward.
To bring justice flowing with compassion.
We are a grace-filled people, drawing water from the wells of love.
When the journey is wild and the way seems long, the fiery spirit lights our path.
When our hearts are thirsty and long for relief, rivers flow in the desert.
When we step into unknown futures, God's blessings greet us at every turn.
When we are called from the wilderness into the wilderness, wells of grace go ahead of us.
We are spirit-led people, walking gently in the paths of justice and peace.
Rejoice and celebrate.
For unexpected grace pours forth among us.
Hope blossoms in the desert.
Water gushes from a rock in the wilderness.
We are beloved ones of the holy. Let us worship together with joy.
Wade in the water. Wade in the water, children. Wade in the water. God's gonna trouble the water.
Our scripture reading for this afternoon is taken from the book of Isaiah, chapter 35. I will start reading from verse 1 to verse 8. And this is a reading from the New Living Translation Bible. Even in the wilderness and desert, we'll be glad in those days. The wasteland will rejoice and blossom with spring crocuses. Yes, there will be an abundance of flowers and singing with joy. The deserts will become as green as the mountains of Lebanon, as lovely as Mount Carmel or the plain of Sharon. There God will display glory, the splendor of the Holy One. With this news, strengthen those hands, those who have tired hands, and encourage those who have weak knees. Say to those with fearful hearts, be strong and do not fear, for love is coming to put things right. Then spring will gush forth in the wilderness, and streams will water the wasteland. The parched ground will become a pool, and springs of water will satisfy the thirsty land. Marsh grass and reeds and rushes will flourish where desert jackals once lived. And a great road will go through that once deserted land. It will be named the Holy Way. May God bless the Holy Scriptures. Amen.
Way in the water, wade in the water, children, wade in the water. God's gonna trouble the water.
Parched, hot air swirled along the wilderness roads, filled with thirst for love, for hope, for life. But then everyone suddenly burst out singing, and I was filled with such delight as caged birds must find in freedom, winging wildly across the earth, on and on. Everyone's voice was suddenly lifted, and beauty came like gushing water, springing from wells deep within. My heart was shaken with tears, and fear drifted away. Oh, but everyone was a bird, and the song was wordless. The singing will never be done.
Wade in the water. Wade in the water, children. Oh, God's gonna trouble the water.
Following God's leading, the whole community of Israel journeyed into the wilderness, moving from one place to another. Eventually, they set up camp at Rephidim, but there wasn't a drop of water to drink. The people were thirsty. The animals were thirsty. Even the very earth they walked on was thirsty. They begged Moses in desperation,
"Give us water to drink."
But Moses said,
"Why are you complaining to me? And why are you putting God to the test?"
But the people were so thirsty, they continued to implore him,
"Please tell us we didn't come all this way, out of the horror of slavery in Egypt, across the Red Sea, through miles of desert wilderness, to die here of thirst."
Then Moses cried out to God,
"What should I do with these people, my beloved community? They are about ready to gather all these rocks and hurl them at me."
God said to Moses,
"Take some of the leaders with you and go on ahead of the rest of the people. Also, take the walking stick you used to perform miracles on the Nile River in Egypt. When you get to the rock at Horeb, I'll be present with you. Strike that rock with that stick, and the water will gush out of it for the people to drink."
So Moses struck the rock,
and all the water flowed.
There's a difference between being put out and being put outdoors. If you are put out, you go somewhere else. If you are outdoors, there is no place to go. Dead doesn't change, and outdoors is here to stay. Toni Morrison from The Bluest Eye. Reverend Dr. Yvette Flunder is an unapologetic disciple and proponent of the radically inclusive love of Jesus Christ, who has raised her voice for justice from the church house to the White House and steps of the Supreme Court. She is a graduate of the Certificate of Ministry Studies and Masters of Arts programs at Pacific School of Religion, and she received her Doctorate of Ministry degree from San Francisco Theological Seminary in San Anselmo, California. Those of us who stand outside the circle of this society's definition of acceptable women, those of us who have been forged in the crucibles of difference, those of us who are poor, who are lesbians, who are black, who are older, know that survival is not an academic skill. It is learning how to stand alone, unpopular and sometimes reviled, and how to make common cause with those others identified as outside the structures in order to define and seek a world in which we can all flourish. It is learning how to take our differences and make them strengths. Audre Lorde from Sister Outsider. A native San Francisco and third generation preacher with roots in the Church of God in Christ, Bishop Flunder, ordained in both the United Church of Christ and the Metropolitan Community Church, has successfully united the message of the gospel with social justice ministry in action for over 30 years. This call to blend proclamation, worship, service, and advocacy on behalf of the most marginalized in church and society gave birth to the City of Refuge, UCC, which Bishop Funder founded in 1991, along with 15 other charter members. For 22 years, City of Refuge called San Francisco its home and grew into a thriving inner city congregation with local, state, national, and international influence, preaching a message of extravagant welcome, restoration, and action within God's beloved community. The congregation has experienced both numerical and spiritual growth, and in the fall of 2013, relocated to Oakland, California. I had crossed the line of which I had so long been dreaming. I was free, but there was no one to welcome me in the land of freedom. I was a stranger in a strange land, and my home, after all, was down in the old cabin quarter with the old folks and my brothers and my sisters. But to this solemn resolution I came. I was free, and they should be free also. I would make a home for them in the north, and in the Lord helping me, I would bring them all here. And oh, how I prayed then, lying alone in the cold, damp ground. Oh, dear Lord, I said, I ain't got no friend but you. Come to my help, Lord, for I'm in trouble. Harriet Tubman, the Moses of her people. In June 2003, Reverend Dr. Funder was consecrated bishop of the fellowship, renamed the Fellowship of Affirming Ministries in 2011. A multi-denominational coalition of primarily African-American Christian leaders and laity representing churches and faith organizations from all parts of the United States and extending to Mexico, three countries in Africa, and most recently Asia. TFAM is a covenantal relationship with the United Church of Christ, the Metropolitan Community Church, and the Centers for Spiritual Living. I have been in sorrow's kitchen and looked out all the pots. Then I have stood on the peaky mountain wrapped in rainbows with a harp and a sword in my hands, Zora Neale Hurston. While concluding her tenure at PSR as a PSR trustee this year, she continues her work as an adjunct professor and speaker here at numerous seminaries, including Auburn, Bright Divinity, Chicago Theological, Drew, Duke, Eden, Howard, Lancaster, New York Theological, and Yale. A much sought after and prophetic preacher, educator, and justice advocate, Funder is also a renowned gospel music artist, and she is the author of Where the Edge Gathers, a theology and homiletic of radical inclusion. In 2011, she received the Robert C. Kirkwood Community Leadership Award from the City of San Francisco Community Foundation, and she is an active voice for Human Rights Campaign and the National Black Justice Coalition. Now, anybody can tell a good wilderness story. But a woman in a wilderness story knows her Exodus story. Anybody can read a map and know its legends, but a woman in a wilderness story always knows what she is running to and what she is running from. Anybody can flip a switch and turn on the lights, but a woman in a wilderness story knows that that's not illumination. A woman in a wilderness story knows her power and knows that a kiss blown into two sticks can start a fire. Anybody can read a compass and find out which direction to go in, but a woman in a wilderness story can look at God and demand to know where she stands with God. A woman in a wilderness story is named Eve. Or a woman in a wilderness story might be named Rahab. Or a woman in a wilderness story withholds her name because she knows that history, biblical, and world could never get her right. Her name might be Noah's wife or Jephthah's daughter or the Syrophoenician woman. A woman in a wilderness story is not hidden from God. In fact, she knows that there is no hiding. The wilderness is all out in the open, and she knows that God knows. She came here in the thick and thicket of it all to talk to God. She knows gardens and God's backwoods like the steeple of her facing palms and the black side of her hands. A woman in a wilderness has vision and can squint and discern and prophesy in the direct sun of God or the dark of God. A woman in a wilderness story knows that in nature, every advantage increases her survival, including the ability to hide herself from predator and prey. And a woman in a wilderness story knows the metaprosis, knows to translocate her pigment, knows that sometimes she chooses between the full bloom of herself and the camouflage of herself. And a woman in a wilderness story knows that God must see a woman in everything if a woman is to see a God in anything. And a woman in this wilderness story is our speaker of the hour, bringing forth our commencement message, Bishop Yvette A. Flunder.
Where's Pat Gill? There's it. Oh, there's Charlene. Oh, come on, come on. Let her come to the piano. Come to the piano, Pat. Let's go to church for a minute. Yeah. Give me a good Pentecostal key.
In shady green pastures, so rich and so free, God leads God's dear children. Leads us along by the waters cool flowing to bathe the weary child's feet. God leads God's precious children, leads us along. God will take some of us through the water. Some of us through the fire. Oh, but all of us through the blood. And God takes some of us, hallelujah, through great trial. And sing in the night season and all the day long. Just one more. And God takes some of us through the water. God has taken some of us through the fire, but I'm so glad all of us come through the blood. Oh, God takes some of us through grace.
sorrow. Oh, God gives us. God gives us. Hey. God gives us a song. I've got a song I can sing in my night season, and I can sing it all the day, all day long.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Pat. I'm blessed to have known Pat Gill all of my life, well, at least all of her life. I'm a little bit older than her, and her father and my grandfather were best of friends. And my grandfather left the hospital early from tumor surgery on the day of her grandfather's funeral. And he left without his doctor's permission and asked his driver if he would simply drive him by the church where the funeral was being held. And he sat in the car and wept before he went back to the hospital to finish his treatment. That's the way my grandfather and her father loved each other for years and years in the ministry. I'm blessed to know Pat is here. Amen. At PSR. Yes. Amen. Amen. Continuing her ministry education. And that fabulous woman that you saw standing in the wings there is Minister Charlene Moore, who is the capable minister of music at City of Refuge United Church of Christ. Thank you for giving Pat an opportunity to gospelize the piano for us today. What a blessing to be here. I watched a video of the life of a herd of elephants in the Kalahari Desert in Africa. And this was during the dry season. And the baby elephant in this documentary had been born during the dry season. And the family was struggling for water and for food. This matriarchal family. And they were in extreme struggle, and of course, the very young and the very old were struggling most. And the baby began to drop back as she got weaker and weaker and weaker from the combination of lack of food and water, dryness, and excessive heat. She eventually died. And her mother, the matriarch of this herd of elephants, mourned her with great sorrow. And she swayed from side to side. And she groaned and she groaned. And she took her great trunk and she pushed her baby again and again in an attempt to revive her. What I thought was exceptional in this documentary was that the rest of the herd slowed down measurably so as to give this matriarch the time that she needed to mourn her child. So they stayed within scent range so that when she knew the time had come and it was time to go, she could pick up the scent of her sister kin and their children and head toward them to move on with the rest of her life. And as David Attenborough narrated this life and death struggle,
I also learned something else I didn't know. That beneath this spot in the vast Kalahari Desert in Africa is a massive underground cave and an enormous freshwater lake system. Essentially, what is now a desert was once a vast inland sea. The name of the lake is Dragon's Breath Lake. You can check it out and Google it. You'll find out that Dragon's Breath Lake is the world's largest underground lake, filled with fresh, cold water, and it lies just beneath the place where the baby died. The lake is incredibly deep, so much that three jumbo jets, nose to tail, could stand on one another in the best estimates. 328 feet of it have been explored by human beings with no sign of the bottom when they gave up the exploration. All of this water has been trapped here undisturbed for perhaps millions of years. Yet in this cave, there is life. Golden catfish would be catfish. Catfish. You say to my sons and daughters and sisters and brothers that are graduating today, catfish represent resilience. I used to have a tank of fish, freshwater fish, and I had some angelfish and some beautiful, beautiful shrimp, freshwater shrimp, and had some beautiful bright colored blue fish and some yellow fish. And so somebody said you need to buy some catfish to keep your tank clean. So I did. I bought some freshwater cats. Y'all know what I'm talking about, freshwater catfish. Put them in the tank, and I'd come back, and one of my fish would be gone. I didn't know what happened to them. Disappeared. I said, stuff happens. You know what I'm saying. I looked at the top of the tank, and I couldn't find anything to suggest that the fish was dead. I said, well, perhaps he or she is hiding underneath some of the regalia that was in the fish tank. Came back the next day, another fish gone. It didn't dawn on me until I saw the ectoskeleton of my shrimp that something was eating my fish. Catfish were growing exponentially large. Because catfish know how to survive. Anybody feel what I'm saying, right? Yet the golden catfish is the rarest and most isolated fish in the world because it only lives in Dragon's Breath Lake. It is the only living thing in Dragon's Breath Lake. And you might ask, which would be the logical question, how do they survive down in the lake? Well, they eat garbage and debris and fecal matter that falls from the surface between the cracks down into the crevices, and it works its way down into the lake water. They are totally blind. They live in total darkness beneath one of the most arid regions in Africa. This is what David Attenborough called cruel irony. So much water, and it's completely out of reach. So much water, and it's completely out of reach. The desert and dry land, Isaiah said, Isaiah 35, will become happy, and the desert will be glad, and it will produce flowers. Like a flower, it will have many blossoms. It will show its happiness as if it were shouting with joy, and the blind will see again. The deaf will hear, and the cripple will jump like a deer. And those who can't talk now will shout. Because water will flow in the desert. Because water will flow in the desert. Because water will flow in the desert. There is more than enough water in this example, but it appears that it has to be tapped in order to get the water and the desert married to one another. Cruel irony, David Attenborough said. So I began to ask my own happy self. I said, why are there wars everywhere when peace is possible? Why are there hungry people anywhere when there is more than enough capacity to feed everyone? And why is America on its backside and underside, arming itself and building bunkers in its backyards? And why is our news filled with continued shooting rampages such that we have almost become numb to the news? And sisters and brothers, why can't we overcome racism? It's a false truth anyway, because I'm a lot of different things. I'm a West African, and I'm a Cherokee, and I'm Irish. Why can't we get past racism? And why can't we overcome homophobia? Why can't we overcome heteroprivilege? Why can't we prioritize our caring for the planet and stop blaming our disasters on an angry God and the gays? It's always those gays. Reason for everything that goes wrong, those gays, I tell you. Why can't our veterans be properly cared for? Why? The question is, with as much as we talk about religion and faith and hope, why is anyone dry or sad or addicted or broken? And why is there so much water available and seemingly out of reach, even to those of us who name the name of God constantly and perpetually? Why, sisters and brothers? Why, sons and daughters? Why? Someone once said to me, with all the destruction that is happening in the earth, why won't God do something about it? And I responded, and God is asking you the same question. Why won't you do something about it? If we are going to respond to the need to marry our water with our desert, we have first to look inward. It begins with each of us seeking the living, life-changing water that is inside of us. If I were at City of Refuge, I'd say, turn to your neighbor. And I would say to them, there is greatness in you. There is greatness in you because God is in you. Oh, honey, if you don't take anything else home that I said to you today, there is greatness in you because God is in you. What does it mean? Stop looking for everyone else's water or expecting everyone else's water to make a way for you. There is water in you. Look to your own well. Why would you die when there is a well of healing water inside? Where is the purpose? Where is the glory? Where is the joy? Where is the plan of God in me? Why did God allow me to be born out of eternity into time? Why am I here? What is my purpose? what is my call, not just to the graduates, but for every supporter of these graduates in the house. It won't get done till we do it. And let me leave this second point with you. I said to you that the golden catfish was hidden in a lake underneath the Kalahari Desert. Hidden water can sustain life, but just barely. Because life cannot thrive in the dark. Oh, I'm preaching now. Enjoy myself. Essentially, your gifts must come to the light. God is not calling for secret peace warriors. God is calling even us retired hippies, I'm talking to you. Go up in the attic and dust off your sign, get your Birkenstocks out, and let's get back out there again. Let's get the work done. Let's make our voices heard. What good is your water if you don't share it? Hidden water cannot sustain life. Our gifts are of little use if we do not share them. Now, the golden catfish is alive, but alone and blind and eats garbage. Let me do that again. The golden catfish is alive, but he's alone and blind and eats garbage. That's existing. That is not living. You see, the joy of the call, beloved, is when the call is enough to move you from a place of apathy to a place of action. And don't do it to win a popularity contest. We're not in it to win a popularity contest. Those of us who follow the teachings and say that we are disciples of some of the greatest prophets and teachers we have ever known, you know the prophet's way. You know what it is to move out before it becomes popular. You know what it is to be on the page when it's turning. You know what it is to cut away in the desert and wait for the rest of the people to come along. They'll be along after a while. They always come along after a while, but who is it that will go before and cut the way and let the people call you crazy? Do the work that God has called you to. Do the work. Do the work. Many things keep our gifts in the dark. Fear, doubt, negative influences, failure in your past, sadness and anger, people and circumstances. Honey, they'll steal your water. I know what I'm talking about. They'll come and steal your water. They'll see your water and will steal your water because they don't have the courage to carry your water. But I want to say to you today that God is calling us out of the dark, from behind the wall, from behind all of the circumstances that we blame. Say, well, what am I looking for, Bishop Flunder? I don't know. You know what God has called you to. How do I know you know? Because it is in God's best interest to make God's self clear. You know what God is calling you to. You know what God has said to you. Somebody is hoping that you'll get one of those really nice calls from your denomination to a church in the suburbs. How am I doing with that? With an endowment and a retirement plan and a medical benefit and a car and a parsonage. But you can hear the call of God saying, come to the wilderness. Come where the need is greatest. Come, come. I'm calling you, and you want to know, how am I going to make it? And God says, where I lead, I feed. Where I guide, I provide. Hallelujah. Finally, this: to reach the dryness and to do the job needed to nourish the land, the water needed, listen, to well up from where it was. Dryness was up high, water was down low. Oh, God, that'll preach. Take it home with you. The dryness was up high. You hear me, brother? And the water was down low. I've been to Yellowstone Park, and Old Faithful Geyser is called a geyser because the pressure of what is inside cannot be contained. Jeremiah called it fire. I would stop talking, but I can't help myself. He said, it's like fire. Oh, that's how you know there's a call on your life. It's like fire. Marvin, that's why you preach an introduction, because it's like fire. Shut up in your bones. Hallelujah. Bubbles up. That's the way it is with a geyser, because the pressure of what is inside cannot be contained. And periodically, Old Faithful bubbles up and out over anybody who is close by. Oh, I've seen that gift in many of you. There are very few of you who have not been my student at some time along the way, and I've heard you preach, and I've heard you sing, and I've heard you do poetry, and I've watched you dance, and I've seen your fire. I know something about your fire. I know something about your water. I know something about your geyser. The gift that is within you is desperately trying to get out. That is what the gift of God in you is trying always to do. We have the ability to suppress it, but it ain't healthy. Let me say it again, as ebonically as I can. It ain't healthy to suppress a geyser, because it's like trying to hold a beach ball underwater. Get it in your mind, when you let go, it breaks forth and it throws itself up and out of the water because it can't abide the pressure. We have the ability to suppress it, but I hear the Spirit say today, surrender. Stop repressing your vision and get the people out of your company who tell you it can't be done. There is nothing too hard for God. Oh, it can be done. That's what they have said down through the years to anybody who came along with something new. We don't do it like that. Nobody's ever done it like that. The people before you didn't do it like that. You can't do it. It can't be done. We would still be cavemen and women if somebody did not understand that what seems to be undoable is possible. In fact, all things are possible with God. Surrender to the power of your water. Surrender to the power of your vision. You don't have to know all the particulars. Sometimes God will tell you what without telling you when. Without telling you where. Oh, I got some witnesses. Without telling you who. All you got is a what, but go on the what. Testify and tell him I heard what God wants me to do. And then he'll say, well, how you gonna do it, y'all? I don't know, but I got the what. And I'm moving out on the what. And after a while, I'll get the when. And I'll get the where. And I'll get the who. And I'll also get how I'm gonna pay for it, because God resources God's will. Take this with you. When Jesus talked to the unnamed woman at the well, he said to her, if you knew the gift of God and who it is that asked you for a drink, you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water. Sir, she said, you have nothing to draw water with, and the well is deep. Essentially, Mr. Jesus, how are you going to get the water to my dryness? How do you get this living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us the well and drank from it himself, and as did his sons and his livestock? And Jesus answered, everyone, hallelujah, who drinks this water from this well will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks the water I give them will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give them will become in them a spring of water welling up to everlasting life. And the woman said to him without hesitation, sir, give me this water. Say it in your hearts today, God, give me this water. so that I won't get thirsty and have to keep coming to this place to draw water, to this place, to whatever that place is that you think you have to keep going to. The place is now in you. Something external has become internal. Surrender now to the Spirit's call to bubble up. And I challenge you today, hear my heart. Bring your call and your gift and your dream and your vision and your heart song and your talent. Bring it up from the cave and bring it out into the light. Bring it up with gusto and fervor and effervescence. Scare the people. Bring it up. Bring it all the way up until you wet up your family. Wet up the people on your job. Wet up City Hall. Wet up your denomination. Oh, I'm talking good now. Wet up, just wet up everything so that everywhere you go, water comes forth. I didn't say, here he or she comes again, wetting up everything and everybody. And here's what the apostle said through the word of God. If you believe and listen to the voice of Jesus, if you believe on me, as the scripture hath said, out of your belly will flow rivers of living water. You'll be more than an intellectual. You'll be a spirit filled. Can I say it like my grandmother said it? A Holy Ghost filled. Intellectual such that lives will change. Institutions will change. Denominations will change. Oh, I feel a reformation in the air. I declare to you, if you will believe, as the scripture has said, out of your belly will flow rivers, rivers of living water. It is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
pause now to pray. For these are graduates going forth into wilderness callings of a world in great need. And for the many communities called alongside them to respond to that need and for ourselves.
We pause now to pray in the many names of the holy and the sacred, and in the name of the one known by the ancient Israelites and the one known in Jesus. To the one who brought forth water in the desert and manna in the wilderness.
We pray for all those who thirst after God and hunger for justice. For all those without food for their bodies or nourishment for their souls. And for all who are called to feed them. To the one who calls us from security into courage, from all that is familiar toward unknown horizons.
We pray for a pillar of cloud by day and the fire of divine light by night. For the confidence of faith, the audacity of hope, and for the guidance of love to answer the call. To the one who called Jesus the beloved in his baptism and who calls each of us by name into ministries of service.
We pray for bodily joy and intimacy, for the sustaining presence of those we cherish and who cherish us, and for lives offered in works of compassion and generosity. To the one who pours out the spirit of unity with the gifts of diversity.
We pray for discerning hearts and fearless insight, for wisdom in our truth-telling, and for visions of abundant life in our living.
To the one who calls us and gifts us to respond, we pray with thanksgiving in the call and with gratitude for the gifts of those who go in the power of divine grace. Amen.
Good afternoon to all of you. I am Mo Wright, not Julian Phillips, as it says in the order. I am the treasurer of the Pacific School Religion, and I'm on the Board of Trustees. It is my great joy to bring you greetings on behalf of the trustees. First of all, we'd like to extend our warmest congratulations to all you graduates. You did it. We're proud of you. We'd like to give you a hand. Also, we'd like to wish to extend congratulations to your families, all of you that are here, your spouses, partners, children, parents, siblings, and friends who have supported you on this journey. We all know that seminary is never a solo trip. The community you bring with you and the ones you add to it make your difficult journey possible. So I invite you now, members of the class of 2014, to stand up, turn around, and applaud your family and friends. So they did show up for you today, so. Just to prove it. The trustees also extend our deepest gratitude on this day to Acting President Steve Stirner, who stepped out of retirement to serve and lead this institution with courage, commitment, vision, and grace, and who will return with his wife Judy to South Carolina following today's ceremony. I think his bags are packed and he's ready to go. So we appreciate all that Steve has done for the school in this time of great change. His leadership has set us on a path to continued excellence for years to come. We also extend deep gratitude to the PSR faculty, to the teachers and scholars whose work brings to life the PSR mission statement. We are committed to serving God by equipping historic and emerging faith communities for ministries of justice and compassion in a changing world. We are particularly grateful to Professor Randall Miller, who along with Reverend Jolyn Monahan, who shepherded our first class of Changemaker Fellows, whose presence among us this year has indeed been transformative. We also extend deep gratitude to the PSR staff, to the support staff and the administrative staff, whose hard work keeps this institution moving forward. We are grateful for all that you do to make PSR a wonderful and amazing place to work and study. We particularly extend deep gratitude to Dr. Bernie Schlager, who has ably led us as dean this year and will step in as interim president while we finish our important search process. And finally, we extend deep gratitude to all the alums and friends and generous donors whose support enables us to do something that is very rare, be a seminary committed to progressive Christian leadership, to a full-hearted participation of God's project of creating a just and compassionate world. In closing, I offer the class of 2014 a short piece of advice from that wonderful teacher, the late William Sloan Coffin. Dare to act wholeheartedly without absolute certainty. I pray that your time at PSR has helped you to come alive and helped you to step boldly into the future and helped you to say yes to your calling, your faith, your courage, and your great joy. Congratulations again, and may God bless you all.
The Paul Wesley Yinger Preaching Award is presented each spring to the graduating Master of Divinity student judged to be an outstanding preacher with exemplary presentation skills. Dr. Yinger was a noted United Church of Christ preacher who served as a trustee of Pacific School of Religion from 1962 to 1985. Dr. Yinger was known for his own skills as pastor, administrator, preacher, and dramatist. This endowed award was established in 1994 in memory and recognition of Dr. Yinger's passionate devotion to the delivered word of God and his support of the development of excellent preaching among PSR's student body. There are two 2014 recipients. The first recipient of the Preaching Award is known for his storytelling, insight, and his capacity to be fully attentive to the Holy Spirit in the preaching moment. He has the ability to break open scripture and exegete the texts of experience. He lifts up brothers and sisters who are marginalized or demonized, and he unmasks powers through incisive humor. The depth of the theological insight of his preaching builds up the beloved community. Brian Adkins. Amen. The second recipient is clearly a gifted crafter of words with deep theological understanding and a captivating style. He has an imaginative, creative engagement with the texts and the theme for the day. He speaks the truth in love and issues a passionate call to all who are gathered. He enlivens scripture with contemporary insights, challenging prophetic words, and he engages hearers with his passionate presence. Darnell Fennell.
Good afternoon. My name is Reverend Sharon Lee MacArthur, and I'm a proud alumna of the class of 2001. It is my honor and privilege to present this year's PSR Alumni Association Koinonia Awards. Each year, the association presents these awards to honor two graduating students who have strengthened PSR through outstanding contributions of spirit, insight, and intellect during their time at the school. The Greek word koinonia, which appears frequently in the New Testament, is variously translated as fellowship, community, and sharing. This award seeks to honor students who have made a significant contribution to and greatly enriched the spiritual, social, and community life of PSR through their presence and their efforts, who have served the school through active participation in campus life, institutional committees, and or by helping to create new possibilities for community development, and who have demonstrated academic excellence, thereby contributing to and enhancing the scholarly reputation of PSR. While it is recognized that every student brings unique gifts that enrich and shape the life and identity of the community we know as Pacific School of Religion, there were two names that emerged with consistency among the nominations as distinguishing themselves in these areas. Our first 2014 Koinonia Award recipient received nominations across the spectrum of first-year students and graduating peers, along with faculty members. This student has been described as hardworking and high achieving, even taking on the challenging of excelling in classes that were simply being audited. One nominator marveled at how this student has balanced field education, work, church, and student life, and more with the kind of amazing grace and gracefulness. A faculty member described this student as one who has the capacity to bring other students together within a classroom setting. Not an easy feat by any stretch of the imagination for a PSR class. Still is that way, huh? Known as a person who is feisty and opinionated with a wonderfully wicked sense of humor, this student is also recognized as one who is tender, humble, and considerate of others, and one whom many people, both on and off campus, seek out for support and guidance. A first-year student described this award recipient as one who loves outrageously, embracing the diversity of PSR with abandon, even while celebrating her own cultural heritage, and maintaining an open policy, open door policy, for all who need a word of affirmation, counsel, and love. a consistently nurturing and nourishing presence on this campus, this student has offered back massages to students when the strain of completing or starting an assignment has taken its toll on her or his body, and has helped document the life of community through taking photos of fellow residents. I hear murmurs. This student is probably the best known, however, for demonstrating the principle of koinonia through the building of community around a table of hospitality. Known for a ministry of spiritual care through hosting potlucks for dorm residents when the dining hall is closed, especially for those who do not have individual kitchens or are low on funds, and for baking the sweetest of gluten-free and gluten-full sweets for students, staff, and seminary guests alike. Me too. This graduate has made an indelible impression upon both the stomachs, but more so the hearts and minds of spirits of countless members of the PSR community. Please join me in congratulating, as described by a Cobenton resident, a true Chinese gem, an incredible woman of God, Frances Gwen. Oh, the paparazzi. Our second award recipient also received nominations across the spectrum of entering class members and graduating peers. This person has been described as one who has made a commitment daily to being a part of this community, whether by sitting down to eat with strangers or newcomers to PSR, or serving on a search committee, or planning events, or participating in the life of worship. While noted for being a kind-hearted, warm, friendly, genuinely curious person who has the capacity to motivate other students, faculty, and staff to engage in both conversation and action around difficult subjects, this student has also been described by one peer as one of the most theologically minded and critically thinking persons she knows. Perhaps what resonated most distinctively across the nominations was this student's desire and pursuit of confronting and seeking to go beyond the privilege of personal identity around gender, race, and orientation. One student described this person as one whose work has sought in respectful and tactful ways to address many topics that, particularly spiritual, communities shy away from. This student was further referenced as one who has helped other students have a model for engaging, challenging, and even potentially painful conversations in ways that also move toward healing. In particular, this commitment has been consistently exemplified in this student's passion and advocacy around sexual spiritual violence against women, demonstrated most recently by his work creating a series of events connected to a presentation of the Vagina Monologues in campus in partnership with SFTS. Throughout this time here, this student has also brought persons from the Bay Area Women Against Rape to talk with students and engage the community in addressing issues of domestic violence. A hallmark of this student's creative handiwork is also forever left to imprint the life of worship here at PSR in the papier-mâché image of a pregnant woman bearing the weight of the cross on her shoulders and back. This art piece was first utilized in a Lenten Stations of the Cross service created by the Awaken Worship Group and has been incorporated many times over in various occasions of PSR worship. Finally, described by two first-year students as a gift from God to this community and to the education of the people in it, and as one whom she is proud to call friend, peer, and colleague in ministry. Please join me in congratulating Andrew C. Conley Holcomb.
Afternoon. Have no fear, we're making our way through the schedule. It's my pleasure to present the winner of the Michael M. Mendiola Award in Ethics. Dr. Mendiola, my one-time doctoral advisor, was a beloved PSR ethics professor who had an abiding interest in theodicy, or as one person described it, a determined fascination with whose suffering counts and how you describe such suffering in the context of ethical behavior. Through his teaching and research, Dr. Mendiola, Michael, also explored many other issues in contemporary ethics and was described by many colleagues and students alike as an exceptional teacher and scholar. This year, as in previous years, we received a number of strong essays dealing with a broad range of subjects in contemporary ethics. Indeed, our top two contenders for the Mendiola Prize in Ethics both provided wonderful submissions on two very different topics. Our first runner-up, to whom I want to give an honorable mention, submitted a very fine essay wrestling theologically with issues of suffering and disability through the lens of process theology. Would you please join me in congratulating our runner-up, Andrew Conley Holcomb. So it gives me a special pleasure to announce our actual winner. It demonstrates that long after a student might take your basic introduction course in ethics, those little seeds will sprout and grow, and the student will show you that they listened, learned, and has gone beyond your teaching. This year's winner of the Mendiola Award in Ethics tackled the difficult but very timely subject of just war and violence. By integrating her own military experience and surveying the work of a number of heavy hitter major theological figures, she offered her own understanding of when violence in defense of the weak and the vulnerable and the marginalized can be justified. Please join me in congratulating the winner of this year's prize, Jennifer Wellington.
The Center for Lesbian and Gay Studies in Religion and Ministry at PSR inaugurated an annual essay prize called the Marcella Althaus Reed Award that honors the legacy of Marcella Althaus Reed as a queer Latin American feminist liberation theologian. Sort of covers the waterfront there. We select one essay each year that reflects and continues that really important legacy of connecting these important issues together for a vision, for a truly queer vision of a different world of thriving and abundance for all.
In selecting this year's recipient, we considered both an author whose work continued in the boundary-breaking spirit of Marcella Althaus Reed, but also someone for whom queer theory was not, well, it's not just a theory, but also something that they put into practice, queering our campus in the best way possible. And so we selected a recipient whose work challenged the gender binary, both in the classroom and in our community life, and took concrete steps to make our campus and our world more inclusive, more welcoming, more liberated, and liberating.
And so this year's Marcella Althaus Reed Award goes to the student who wrote a wonderful essay entitled, When the Line Becomes a Circle, an Eco-Queer Theology. And that student is Stee Kinney Fields.
It's our understanding that Stee is not present today, but we will make sure that they get the certificate, and we thank you for joining us in congratulating them on this well-deserved award.
I can't hear you.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, I can hear you.
We have come to the time in the ceremony where we offer the gift from the 2014 class.
And so with great gratitude and thanksgiving, we are proud to announce that we met our $1,500 goal. And so we are gifting wireless mics, a projection screen for the PSR Chapel to enhance the worship experience.
And we would like to thank the committee that helped to put this together.
Andrew Holcomb, Angela Brown, Diane Johnson, and me.
And the faculty and staff, Reverend Elizabeth Ann Jefferson, and Dr. Sharon Fanema. Yes.
We now come to at least part of what you've all been waiting for. Will the candidates for the Certificate of Theological Education for Leadership please rise and come forward? Mr. President, because these students have completed a designated one-year online program of theological exploration and study, I am authorized by vote of the faculty and trustees to present them as candidates for the Certificate of Theological Education for Leadership. In their cases and the others to follow, it is understood that graduation is contingent upon completion of all academic requirements at the end of this academic year. Say amen.
In the name and under the authority of the faculty and trustees of Pacific School of Religion, I confer upon each of you the Certificate of Theological Education for Leadership, with all the rights and privileges appertaining thereto. In witness thereof, I present you with this certificate.
Anthony Jeffrey Bailey. Bobby Jean Baker, posthumously. Emma Denise Milligan, in absentia. Joy Lynn Osher. Joy Lynn Roan. Roxanne K. McKenzie Shaw. Jeannie Wilson Skoog and Rachel Williams in absentia. Will the candidates for the Certificate of Sexuality and Religion please rise and come forward? Mr. President, because these students have completed a designated course of study with specialized training in sexuality, sexual orientation, gender identity, and religion, I am authorized by vote of the faculty and the trustees to present them as candidates for the Certificate of Sexuality and Religion.
In the name and under the authority of the faculty and trustees of Pacific School of Religion, I confer upon you the Certificate of Sexuality and Religion, with all the rights and privileges appertaining thereto. In witness thereof, I present you with this certificate.
Dora LaFlora. Shannon Marie Goris. And in absentia, Kelly Kraus and Silvana Krogswood. The candidate for the Certificate of Swedenborgian Theology. Mr. President, because this student has completed a designated course of study with specialized training in Swedenborgian thought, I am authorized by vote of the faculty and the trustees to present her as a candidate for the Certificate of Swedenborgian Theology.
In the name and under the authority of the faculty and trustees of Pacific School of Religion, I confer upon you the Certificate of Swedenborgian Theology with all the rights and privileges appertaining thereto. In witness thereof, I present you with this certificate.
In absentia, Joy T. Barnetts. We are pleased today to award the Certificate of Theological Studies to our inaugural cohort of Changemaker Fellows. Will these candidates for the Certificate of Theological Studies please come forward? Mr. President, because these students have completed a designated one-year immersive course of study, integrating theological reflection and spiritual formation with leadership for social change, I am authorized by vote of the faculty and trustees to present them as candidates for the Certificate of Theological Studies.
In the name and under the authority of the faculty and trustees of Pacific School of Religion, I confer upon each of you the Certificate of Theological Studies with all the rights and privileges appertaining thereto. In witness thereof, I present you with this certificate.
Dinah Becton. Demetrius Grimes Burnett. Malcolm Jamil Bird. Dorian Leslie Duran. Emilio Hernandez. Claudia Rosemary May. Jeremy Sorgan in absentia. Marvin K. White. Will the candidates for the degree of Master of Theological Studies please rise and come forward? Mr. President, because these students have completed a prescribed two-year course of theological study, I am authorized by vote of the faculty and trustees to present them as candidates for the degree of Master of Theological Studies.
In the name and under the authority of the faculty and trustees of Pacific School of Religion, I confer upon each of you the degree of Master of Theological Studies with all the rights and privileges appertaining thereto. In witness thereof, I give you a diploma and cause you to be invested with a hood for this degree.
Stephen A. Haynes. Laura Lewis Rollin. Lucia Van Diepen in absentia. Jasmine Herrick. Steve Kinney in absentia. Andrew Nathan Van Dyke. Will the candidates for the degree of Master of Divinity please rise and come forward? Brian David Adkins. Hope Attenhofer in absentia. Claire Bowman. Angela Brown. Mariah Lee Callison. Wesley Douglas Capps. Andrew C. Conley Holcomb. Michael T. Cronin. Loma Julene Eves. Darnell Fennell. Norma Gwynn Fuque. Shannon Marie Goris. Andrew Greenhaw in absentia. Ofa Uepe Haunga. Michael Deborah Haven. Watnak Heng. Jillian Bartlett Hutton. Diane Janine Johnson. Aninda Carr. Emily Marie Labreck. Leslie Leisure. Ben Lunine. J.C. Parr. Gina Ann Pond. Pepper Swanson. Ronald Philip Lee Tanner. William Beck Davis Tanner. Sheila Y. Thomas. Alafua Tupo. Jennifer Ruth Wellington. Francis Quen Phan Wong. Will the candidates for the degree of Doctor of Ministry please rise and come forward? Mr. President, because these students have completed a prescribed course of graduate professional study with the presentation of a thesis, I am authorized by vote of the faculty and the trustees to present them as candidates for the degree of Doctor of Ministry.
In the name and under the authority of the faculty and trustees of Pacific School of Religion, I confer upon each of you the degree of Doctor of Ministry with all the rights and privileges appertaining thereto. In witness thereof, I give you a diploma and cause you to be invested with a hood for this degree.
Taehyun John An. And the following three in absentia: Sarah Moldenauer Salazar, Imelda Aquino Ramos, and Dean Worthington. Will the candidates for the degree of Master of Arts please rise and come forward? Mr. President, because these students have completed a prescribed two-year course of study with the presentation of a thesis, I am authorized by the vote of the faculty and the trustees to present them as candidates for the degree of Master of Arts. Sung Lei Cho, in absentia. Jennifer Kemp. Suchi Lin. And the following in absentia: Michael Langley, Joel Layton, C. Alexander Ortiz, and Justin Stoller.
Well, the time is almost 9. As a valedictory charge for this class of 2014, I'd like to offer my gratitude to the Apostle Paul for crafting these words and ask his apology for my recrafting them. Go forth into God's world in peace. Now, that doesn't mean to give up your prophetic rage, for prophetic rage will transform the world. But it is to remember that when prophetic rage and nonviolence are combined, we have seen in ancient days and our days, the world does change. Go forth into the world at peace, knowing that God is with you, around you, and for you. Go into the world with courage. Now, I think courage means lots of things, but I think for you it will mean patience. It is possible, but unlikely, that you will transform the world this year. Your courage will be the fortitude you take to a task that the world keeps trying to defeat you in. Holding fast to the promises and possibilities that are in your spirit because God's Spirit has called you. Hold fast to that which is good. You will be tempted time and time again to substitute success for faithfulness. Faithfulness is good. Hold fast to that which is good. Render to no person evil for evil. Much of the evil done in this world has been in righteous revenge. Do not treat others as they have treated you, but offer to them the open heart and hand of one who truly believes and trusts in the maker of all creation. Help the afflicted, honor the weak. Many will strive on commencement to attain places of high standing, and you may do so, but you will not gain them at the expense of another. You cannot get there if others don't go with you. You cannot be there if you do not see those who need the authority of your power and place to lift them to where you are and give them the blessing of wholeness, of healing, and of acceptance. Sisters and brothers, go into God's world in joy. There's enough pain. There's enough conflict. There is enough discouragement. You do not need to take that with you. If you have it, leave it here. Enter the world rejoicing, for you have been called to a high and holy calling. Wherever you are, God is. You cannot be where God is not. And wherever God is, there is joy in your soul, because your soul and God are one. So, sisters and brothers, we send you forth into the world, called, blessed, guided, strengthened, comforted, degreed. Go in peace.
All right. Thank you, Steve. And as we bring to a close this 147th commencement exercises of the Pacific School of Religion, I would like to extend our very best wishes to PSR's acting president, Steve Sterner, and his wife, Judy, who has graciously shared him with us over the past year. Words cannot convey the depth of our gratitude for both of you. Thank God for you and your service to PSR. We are grateful that as the Presidential Search Committee continues its work, Dr. Bernie Schlager will begin serving as PSR's interim president, and Dr. Randall Miller will serve as our interim dean. Dr. Boyoung Lee, Associate Professor of Practical Theology, Education and Spiritual Formation, will serve as the faculty coordinator for the 2014-15 Changemaker Fellows. With the close of this academic year, we also bid farewell and God's blessings to visiting Professor of Ethics, Law, and Peace Studies, Dr. Terrence Wiley, who will begin his work as Assistant Professor, Religion Studies Department, Africana Studies Cluster at Lehigh University in Bethlehem, Pennsylvania. We note with sadness the passing during the past year of several important members of our community, including PSR alumna and former adjunct faculty member Alma Gardner and former trustee David Reese. During the fall 2014 semester, we will welcome back Professor Aaron Brody, who will be returning from sabbatical leave, and we will also welcome Dr. Sharon Fenema as the newly called assistant professor. Assistant professor of Christian worship and director of worship life. And Dr. Yi Jan Lin as the newly called assistant professor of New Testament. This brings to a close the 147th commencement exercises. We will reconvene for the new academic year on September 2nd, 2014. At this time, you are warmly invited to join the graduating class for the president's reception in the fellowship hall down this way. May God continue to bless the Pacific School of Religion.
We turn to the South and we share our gratitude for the passion of all of our teachers, of all of our preachers, of all of the people who have come together today to celebrate us, who have raised their hands, their voices, and their spirits to honor all of the hard work that has been accomplished here. Thank you for the fire and the passion of all.
Where the light begins, but also new beginnings start and end as Thank you for all the friendships, all the relationships that you built throughout this season, and the new seasons that you're beginning, the new chapters of the book. Thank you, Jesus, for all the spirit and the love that you gave to us.
And so send we you, and we pray that all of your deserts may know the water of justice, and let it run down like water, and righteousness like a mighty stream. I have one sadness, and that is that I won't be going with the Samoan brothers and sisters who will be cooking today. Turn and love your neighbor, somebody to your right or to your left, with a handshake or a hug. God bless you. And congratulations.